Welcome to the Tackling Tech Podcast, powered by Dyno. Join us as we tackle all things ed tech with insightful interviews, actionable tips, and strategies that you can implement in your school or district to make technology integration more effective. Whether you're a teacher, a tech coach, or a technology administrator, we're giving you an advantage in your role by sharing stories from people who are passionate about working with their peers and enhancing the learning experience with technology. Thanks for spending some time with us today. Now let's tackle some tech.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Tackling Tech, a podcast that shares stories about how you can build better collaboration in K-12 schools and a show that is dedicated to putting a voice to remote learning. I am Brett McGrath, Vice President of Marketing at Dyno, and excited for today's conversation. Apologies in advance if you're hearing some background construction noise. I'm sitting at the table in my kitchen, and I'm looking across the street, and there is a house that is been worked on for the last 3 days, and they've got like 10 guys out there, and they must be selling it because they're on the roof, they're doing everything, they've got, looks like, nail guns out right now. It's just wild. But that's the craziest part about working at home, is just you see all the traffic that goes through your neighborhood on a regular basis. So that's been a big observation for me over the last 6 months. I've changed my spot in my workspace a few times, upstairs in the guest room, makeshift office, and that got a little stale. And now I'm back downstairs with the windows open, and it's a little more vibrant. But I would encourage everyone, if you can, and you're working at home, you're teaching at home, make some adjustments, because it does definitely inspire new thought and creativity. Hope you enjoyed the episode with Darren Peppard, who wrote The Road to Awesome and was our first superintendent on Tackling Tech. We had a ton of fun with that one. One of our favorite episodes yet. So inspirational. And definitely, if you are looking to upgrade or get some new ideas on leadership, that was the theme of that conversation. We got to have Darren back on. We had a ton of fun with that. Have to definitely announce on Tackling Tech the speaker list for the Progressive Learning Conference. So if you're new to Tackling Tech or you're unfamiliar with the Progressive Learning Conference, at Dyno, we are hosting the Progressive Learning Conference, and it's a week-long deal. It's going to start Monday, September 21st, and it's going to end Friday, September 25th. If you're interested, you can go to dyno.com, and you can register. There's a banner right on the top of the homepage. We did it this way to make it a week long because we know that schedules are crazy right now with back to school, and we wanted to give everyone the opportunity and options to watch when they want to. So there will be a live keynote speech that will take place on the Monday at 12 noon Eastern. That'll be the only live session. Tuesday through Friday, they're all recorded sessions. So I definitely encourage you, if you're interested in consuming any of this content, definitely just go to dyno.com, put in your email address, and we'll follow up with you with the recordings of those presentations so you can watch them on your own time. If you are interested in watching them when they go live, and they will be going live at noon Eastern every day, we will have some fun, engaging things on social media that you'll hear and we'll know about. I'll share it with you on the future episodes of what we'll be doing on Tackling Tech, but that'll be in those emails that you get once you sign up. So you're going to want to sign up if you're interested. All right, I'm like thrilled about the agenda we have and the list of speakers. So our opening keynote, which is on Monday, September 21st at noon, is going to be with Tara Martin, who's an educator, speaker, and author. She is with Dave Burgess Consulting. She is an enthusiastic educator and speaker. We had her on a previous episode of Tackling Tech, and she was awesome. She's going to be her presentation's on Be Real, Educate from the Heart, and her, what real represents to her is relatable, expose vulnerability, always approachable, and learning through life, which I think those topics really are important right now and will help set the stage for the rest of our conversations about specific disciplines within progressive learning. Kick it over to Tuesday. You've got Jill Thompson, who's an associate partner with Education Elements. She's going to be chopping up personalized learning in a breakout session. Her session is Beginning to Personalize Learning with Core Practices. On Wednesday, STEM Breakout with my man Chris Woods, who did a former episode with us. It will be STEM in a Remote Learning World. Day four, we've got a trio of presenters. It's the Flip Learning Breakout with Eric Geis, Kyle Nemus, and Nick Johnson. Their session is Flipped Flopped, Growing with Every Challenge. Excited about that one. Those guys are super smart and passionate, so that should be fun. And then the final session will be on Friday, and it will be with someone new to our audience who I actually will be having a conversation with this week, and we'll have a podcast episode next week. So that's George Valenzuela, who's an education coach, author, and advocate. He is day five is SEL and PBL breakout session. His session is Make Remote Learning Engaging for Students by Focusing Equity, SEL, and PBL. I had a chance to chat with George a couple days ago, and just so much energy and so much passion. So I couldn't be more thrilled about who we're bringing to you to learn from. So definitely go to dino.com, go to the top of the page, hit that banner, register. You'll get access to those sessions. It is going to be awesome. Definitely hit the subscribe button on Tackling Tech if you like what you heard. Go follow us on all of our social channels at Dino. On Instagram, it's at Dino_K12. We've got a dedicated Twitter handle to the podcast at Tackling Tech Pod. Go check us out. Say what's up. We love hearing from you. Today's episode is really, really fun. I had a great conversation with John Spencer. John is a former middle school teacher that is currently a college professor. He's also an author. He's done a ton. And my big takeaway from learning about John and talking to John is that he really got in front of this virtual and remote learning that we're all in right now. And he is now getting to take his subject matter expertise and share his insights on the best ways to approach it with K-12 districts across the country. Really smart guy. Had a ton of fun with this one. Get out your notepad. There's a lot to learn here. Hope you enjoy this one. I'm going to kick it to the conversation. All right, everybody. Welcome back to Tackling Tech. I am really excited for today's conversation. I am joined by Dr. John Spencer. He is a former middle school teacher and current college professor on a quest to transform schools into bastions of creativity and wonder. On his website, it says he wants to see teachers unleash the creative potential in all of their students so that kids can be makers, designers, artists, and engineers. He wants to explore research, interview educators, deconstruct system, and study real-world examples of design thinking and action, and just digging into what he's about and speaking with him before. I think there is so much that we're going to unpack here and he's going to offer. So I'm excited for this conversation. How are you doing today, John?
I'm doing great.
How are things on your end during this back to school, I guess, back to college for you and your work? How are things going?
It's been busy, but it's been good busy, right? It's been a lot of, I've been working with different professors who have never taught virtually or online. So they've never done, you know, asynchronous virtual or asynchronous online or, you know, the synchronous virtual video meetings, that kind of stuff. So it's been a lot of fun. And then I've been working with, you know, different districts and teachers. So it's just been it's been packed, but it's been packed with things that feel meaningful and enjoyable.
Yeah. I think in just chatting with you before this, it's cool to hear someone who's been dedicated to kind of learning from a virtual setting, and now you get to apply what you know and help share that with others. So that is super cool. And I'm curious, you know, you're a former middle school teacher, you jumped to a college professor. That seems somewhat atypical to me. I'm curious if you could maybe discuss that path you've had along the way.
Yeah. So, you know, it was interesting. I wasn't necessarily thinking of, you know, moving to higher education. I was I was loving teaching middle school. You know, I started out as a social studies teacher. Then I moved to teaching all subjects in a self-contained classroom. And it was a mix of students who were ELL, gifted, and special ed. And that was a lot of fun. And then after that, I just really loved the idea of the freedom that I had in teaching a couple of electives. So I started teaching STEM and journalism, kind of photojournalism, digital journalism, not like a school newspaper style journalism. It was more, I guess you could say, modern journalism or digital journalism. And I was loving it. I was enjoying it. And then somebody contacted me and said, you know, there's this job in Oregon. It's a professor of educational technology, and they're really looking for people with experience, not just in ed tech, but in things like design thinking and project-based learning. And I thought, you know, this sounds actually really exciting. At that point, I was starting to do a lot of professional development. I'd been doing some keynotes and workshops, and I thought, I'm enjoying working with teachers. I'd also been a teacher mentor, so I had gotten to work with teachers who were getting into kind of student-centered learning. And so I applied, and I honestly didn't think I would get it because, you know, I didn't have a doctorate at the time. And, you know, most people who make that jump have a doctorate, or they have, you know, experience as a principal or things like that. So I honestly didn't think I would get it. And then I applied and went through the interview process. And then I loved the fact that, you know, the big interview is teaching a 4-hour class with pre-service teachers. So, you know, it was nice that so much of what I was, I guess, evaluated on in terms of a candidate was how well do you actually teach and how well do you actually engage a group of, you know, pre-service teachers in a 4-hour setting.
Yeah, that's some story, and definitely the first time I've kind of heard that in action. But I think it goes to tell everyone, because we talk about on this a lot, and some of the guests have shared about just, you know, creating their own path in K-12 and beyond. And I think it's all about just the people you're meeting, the experiences you're having, and you never know where that's going to end up and lead you. So I think that's super interesting. You have a pretty ambitious statement that I gravitated to when I was doing some research on you about, you know, your quest to transform schools into bastions of creativity and wonder. And, you know, you go right to your Twitter page at Spencer Ideas and your pinned tweet. You've got a video about what happens when students engage in authentic PBL. Can you maybe explain from your perspective that kind of ambitious statement that you are driving towards, and then maybe get into kind of what your thoughts are on what the creative classroom is and maybe can look like?
Yeah. So I think, you know, really, I guess that goal, that quest, the thing that I'm into, it's as much for, you know, a reminder for me as for, you know, anyone else. And I'm at a place where I'm working with a lot of, you know, I get to work with a cohort of, you know, 25 pre-service teachers, you know, and we get anywhere between a year and a half to 2 years, depending on the cohort. And so that's kind of, you know, that's a major part of where that comes from. You know, this goal of, I want to see teachers transform their classrooms into bastions of creativity and wonder. And I'm working with these pre-service teachers. It's also a reminder for myself, though. And that was a big, you know, it does sound, I admit, a little bit bold and maybe a little bit even audacious, but it's kind of saying, this is what I want to see. And this is my mission. This is my goal. This is what I'm all about. And then I think it extends to, you know, why I blog and why I write, you know, the videos I create, the blog posts I write, the podcast, the trainings I do. And I've been really lucky. I've gotten to go around the world and work with different teachers with this same mindset and goal.
Yeah. And I think, you know, I think that's super cool because you get the opportunity before these teachers might, you know, hit their districts and classrooms to, you know, share perspective and, you know, drive towards your mission. I guess one future teacher at a time. That's super interesting. Can you maybe unpack for those that might not know, just like your perspective of the creative classroom and what that looks like to you?
Yeah. So I really think, you know, the creative classroom is a classroom that's, you know, first and foremost centered on the idea of student voice and choice. So it's a classroom where students have ownership in their learning, where they're self-directed, you know, and then that means they're both self-managers and self-starters. And that ownership is every part of the creative process, from owning the questions that they ask and the inquiry process, to owning the ideation process and getting to generate their own ideas instead of just kind of following recipe style projects. It's the idea of owning the research process and engaging in critical research. It's the idea of owning the assessment process, so they're constantly engaged in self-assessment and peer assessment in a way that's real and authentic to them. You know, and it's a chance to launch their work to an audience and share it with a broader group. Yeah, I think it's about a space where students are working collaboratively and they're working interdependently and they're solving problems together. You know, I think it's every part of creative thinking. It's students engaging in divergent thinking and finding different uses for items and solving problems. It's connective and systems thinking. You know, it's lateral thinking. It's all these different areas of creative thinking. You know, one of the things that I see a lot of adults say is, you know, I'm not a creative type. And I really don't believe that. I think we're all creative. And I don't buy into the myth of like a creative type. And I think that kids come to school, you know, there's two things I hear adults say all the time that I never hear kindergartners say. And one is, I'm not good at math, right? And the second one is, I'm not an artist. Like, you never hear a kindergartner say that, right?
Right.
And I think creative thinking is saying, you know, we're all problem solvers. We're all creators. We're all makers. And so I think that that's what a creative classroom, you know, looks like and is. But I think it's going to look different in every subject, and it's going to, you know, it's going to physically look different. Right. I mean, sometimes it's online, sometimes it's virtual, sometimes it's in a physical building, sometimes it's a maker space that looks like a, what we think of as a maker space. And sometimes it looks like a studio. But the goal is always to build it on that idea of voice and choice in creative thinking.
Yeah, the marketer in me really gravitates to that, and just the ability of owning and launching and, you know, being proud of your work and, you know, getting feedback and iterating on that. So that like really resonates with me. And as I think back to, you know, my K-12 days, I wish that was going on, because I think it would make me better professionally today. Definitely having those years of experience doing that. Do you have any thoughts on just like the steps that maybe districts, whether it's, you know, the administration or teachers, can take to empower this type of creative classroom and mindset?
So for the administrators and leadership, is that what you're thinking?
Yeah. The administrators and leadership.
I think that, you know, the very first thing that comes to mind for me is that we can't have teachers experimenting and taking creative risks if they don't feel that permission, right? So, you know, we talk often about this idea of having a growth mindset. That means teachers are willing to iterate, they're willing to experiment, they're willing to learn from mistakes and try new things and grow. But I really don't think that you can have grit until you have slack, right? Teachers have to feel that permission. And I think it includes, you know, the way we evaluate teachers. You know, we tend to evaluate them on student performance, and typically student performance on standardized tests. And so we have to change from the get-go how we evaluate teachers. And that's where principals and superintendents and those in charge really have to change the way they assess, rather than just talk about it, right? So if you are saying we want teachers to develop student creativity, and we, you know, that's what we're going for, then we have to say, you know, we're going to evaluate you on creative risk taking. We're going to evaluate you on your willingness to try new things. We're going to evaluate you, and we're going to make it low stakes and instead of high stakes. And it really has to begin there. Then I think beyond that, it comes down to the culture that they set up. When I think about the principals I worked with, where I felt the most empowered, to have, you know, project-based learning and design thinking, they were the principals who gave me the permission to make mistakes. They had my back if parents were frustrated about, you know, the shift in instruction, although that didn't happen often, but, you know, they would be there to say, this is the philosophy. And, you know, I know your child is feeling a little bit disoriented or struggling a little bit with the freedom involved in, you know, a PBL lesson, and, you know, maybe they prefer worksheets or whatever, but this is why we're doing it this way. And then I think it was like culture. It was, you know, these were the principals who honestly, they made it fun to go to work. And I think that's kind of the most understated aspect of it. These were the leaders who said, let's celebrate what's working. They would joke around, you know, there was a lot of humor and levity and joy in the environment. And that creates a space where you just feel the freedom to take those creative risks.
Yeah, I think the culture component is certainly critical. And that's something just over the course of the last few conversations we've had on this show that continues to come up, is that culture shift and that solid foundation that comes from the administration. So I think that's something that continues to come up and is really, really important. So you're doing these workshops, probably it was several months ago in person. Now it's shifted to more of a virtual setting. Who are the, is it mostly teachers that are attending that, or what's your audience? And then what type of feedback do you get after the sessions and after you're running through kind of the creative classroom and PBL and design thinking? What type of feedback do you get?
Well, I think right now, you know, a lot of what we're focusing on is, you know, how do we do this in virtual and in hybrid spaces? So much of what we do tends to be, you know, in the past feel very physical, right? You know, there's movement, there's hands-on making, there's things like that. So a lot of what it's been has been, you know, what does it mean to do this in a space that's virtual and hybrid? You know, the biggest feedback that I get that I really appreciate, that I enjoy, is people saying, I feel like you modeled for us what this would look like in our own classrooms. So, you know, we do, for example, a mini divergent thinking project or a Wonder Day project. And that's part of the online workshop, you know, or the virtual workshop. And, you know, they learn and experience how we can take virtual away from the screen and into our home environment, right? We can do a scavenger hunt that leads to a divergent thinking challenge. We can do things like that. So I think a lot of the feedback has been teachers appreciating that. And then also you're really digging into what does collaboration look like? So everything from the use of synchronous and asynchronous tools to, you know, how we're setting up the different breakout rooms in our virtual chats, you know, in our video chats. So, you know, it has been such a shift for everyone. But I've enjoyed the fact that, you know, in some cases there are teachers who are feeling like, I already know how to do PBL, or I already know how to do design thinking. I just don't know how to do it in this new environment. And so the sense of relief that they have. And then in other cases, it's really fun to watch people say, I'm kind of curious about PBL, kind of curious about design thinking. I'm thinking about having students do projects, but it's so new to me. Plus this virtual thing is so new to me, and it's daunting. And then they leave saying, I feel like there's a blueprint and a plan for how I can do this.
Yeah, that's interesting. Do you think this period of remote and distance learning and you engaging with your audience virtually, do you think this impedes or accelerates the quest that your ambitious quest that you're setting out for, the quest of, you know, building creative classrooms?
Yeah, so I think, you know, it has the potential to do both, right? So we know, for example, that the virtual and hybrid learning have a lot of challenges and a lot of flaws. They can reinforce inequities, and we have to address that. So in some ways it can impede it and inhibit it and throw up some really big real roadblocks. And so I think we have to recognize that and to listen to teachers who are saying, this is not ideal, this is not working. At the same time, I think that there are, we need to be asking ourselves, you know, what can we do in this environment that we can't do in a physical environment? And I think that there are certain areas that can help lead to, you know, a more creative classroom. I think, for example, it is easier than ever to truly differentiate instruction in a way that's not 100% time bound, so that students have a lot of slack in their scheduling. It's an opportunity to teach students how to be self-directed, you know, how to engage in time management, how to, you know, in the classroom, you can talk about owning the project management process and you can help students. But, you know, in a virtual setting, they're going to need to own the project management process. And then you, you know, as a PBL teacher can sit down with them and do these small group meetings. So, yeah, I think looking at the, I guess, sort of hidden advantages of virtual can allow us to actually accelerate the process. But it really comes down to whether or not we're doing the hard equity work to begin with, of making sure there's access, making sure there's the right accommodations for all students. And then we can say, all right, let's make sure that we are finding those, I guess, kind of hidden advantages of virtual, so that the projects are actually more authentic. The collaboration is, you know, is more real.
Totally. That the equity component, I know, is a whole nother topic and it's a big one. But what you were saying regarding, you know, the ownership and having students own their projects, it's funny. You mentioned that in the context of just education, but I think that applies across industries, which is super powerful. I was having a conversation months ago when we first started working remote about with my boss, and we talked about that very topic about our work. So I think that's powerful and it applies across industries. Curious, just in closing here, what type of big bets or outcomes do you have, or are you thinking about making from this school year? It can be either good or bad, but what are you thinking happens on the other side of this year?
Yeah, I really don't know. I mean, it's so hard to figure out. I, you know, what I would love to see, the optimist in me, is I would love to see us use this time to reimagine what school can be. And to, as hard as hybrid is going to be, I would love for us to get into an environment where we are more comfortable with kind of an anywhere, anytime approach. You know, that's what I would love to see. I would love to see us, you know, the new normal when we come back, to be things like a more flexible schedule for students, to take learning outside the four walls of the classroom. You know, I would love for us to say, hey, there were some things during this time of quarantine, as awful and hard as it has been, and I don't want to minimize that, but I would love for us to look at that and then just step back and say, now, based on that, like, what are some things that we can integrate in that work? And I would love to see, you know, true, authentic project-based learning happening in a real blended and hybrid way.
Yeah, that's awesome. And I think that's very aspirational. And hopefully we will see that more and more a year from this time. But that's what we talked about on this episode. And I know you share information regarding PBL, Creative Classroom, you name it, all over the place. So where can people who are listening follow you or engage with you and consume some of the content that you're producing?
Yeah, so if you're interested, my blog is spencerauthor.com. And you can find a lot of different stuff there. I have a design thinking toolkit there that you can download. There's a PBL toolkit. I have a little virtual learning hub with all kinds of different articles I've been writing on it, some webinars that you can access on it. And so, yeah, I would love for you to check it out. You know, sometime in the next month or so, I'll be putting out a book on this idea of student-centered learning in, you know, virtual and hybrid spaces. And so if you want to take a deeper dive into that, that book will be out sometime in the future. There's no release date yet, but yeah, I mean, there's a lot of free resources on my website. So check it out at spencerauthor.com. And then I'm hopefully going to be getting into making more videos related to this. I'm more of the deep dive how-to type videos. So if you subscribe to my YouTube channel, it's spencervideos.com. That would be awesome as well.
I've got to ask you, have you thought about, on the video side, have you thought about doing what you're doing on YouTube, but in a TikTok fashion at all?
No, I just can't, I just can't do TikTok. It's, it's too like frenetic for me. I think there's like, it's way too frenetic. Although I was, I'll tell you, I was doing something in my office and I was like, that's why I don't have a TikTok account. Cause that's what I would do. So I was like trying to solve a problem and think through something. It had to do with course design and designing a new course at, you know, at a university. And, I grabbed the squeaky toys for that my dogs have. I have a giant Great Dane in my office right now, and I started playing with the squeaky toys and like playing a song. And I thought, oh my gosh, if I had TikTok, it would be it wouldn't be like talking about instruction or teaching. It would be like recreating my favorite songs with squeak toys, and that's why I don't have a TikTok, because like that's exactly what I would do.
I know, you jump in the wormhole. I think there's opportunity with in K-12 education. We're still trying to crack the code, but it's very, very distracting. So everyone go check out John's stuff. We'll put it in the show notes. Thank you so much for taking the time. I know our audience is going to learn something, so really appreciate it.
Yeah, no problem. It was fun.
Hope you enjoyed that conversation with John. We certainly did. If you want to hear more, hit that subscribe button. Go to dino.com, register for the Progressive Learning Conference. We'll send you the recordings. You don't even need to be there. It's going to be fun. You're going to learn a ton. Hopefully back to school is going well for you. Take care of yourself. Take care of others around you. And we'll talk to you real soon.